that when I look at the issues, I don't think trying to change the mind frames of people who are older and are stuck in their ways is worth the resource or the energy. I think putting the energy into young people is the key.
When I'm running, I feel like I'm actually flying.
My favourite part is the last 40, holding my top end speed.
A lot of people are born into poverty. They don't ask for this, they don't deserve this. And at the same time, on the flip side, you don't deserve the wealth that you accompany because you were born into wealth.
We want to retain our individuality as a race. If judged by your standards, we fall short. Does it matter very much whether we square up with the parking lot standards or not?
Mēnā ko tāu ko tētahi ao haukura, he rea ki tētahi manako, kaua ki te tangata ki te aha noa iho rāne.
On the blocks, my competitive nature takes over.
All I just think about is,
how am I going to execute the race?
The gun goes. I'm just like running, man.
When I'm running, I feel like I'm actually flying.
My favorite part is the last 40, holding my top end speed. My name is Abid Rahman, but you guys can call me Eddie or Ed or Eddie Das. I am a 100 meter and a 200 meter sprinter.
You look at him and you think, oh my God, is this for real, this kid? You know, he's only 18 years old, he's 1.90 meters. His glutes and his hamstrings and his back of his legs are just so big and powerful. Where has he come from? He's been doing weights since he turned 2 or something like that. Genetically, he's an unbelievable specimen.
Was born in Ghana and...
Well, I was brought up in Whangapura in Auckland.
My dad was a sprinter for New Zealand from 1990 to 2000.
I went to the Olympics and Commonwealth Games, then a couple of World Championships. I set the record 1994 Commonwealth Games.
His record is 10:11 in the 100, and my goal is to get that record under 10 seconds. So far, I've run 10:19 in the 100 and 20:76 in the 200. It's just I need to be the best that I can be and like also run under 10 seconds so I could just lead the way for the Kiwis.
Even when he started crawling, Eddie would not sit still. He took his first step 10 months. It was there that he noticed he's special. He was very quick. You put him here and it's gone.
But I have to leave NZ at the age of 9, and I moved to Canberra and just settled there. One thing I enjoyed about Canberra was the AIS track. And like my training ground, like I always call my program my happy place. I always feel like I don't fit in. I want to be a sports star, but my friends just want to go out partying and drinking. I just want to like go my own pathway.
Ah, it's beautiful. Good old windy Wellington. It is a really great story here for Wellington. I issued an invitation to him and his father to come to our Capital Classic, and so we flew them over from Canberra and he won the 100, and the season just took off after that. He came back and ran the Nationals, then obviously he took out the Australian senior title, which was an amazing feat for a young kid, and then earned himself a spot at the Doha World Championship.
Appreciate it.
That first visit in January last year, he hooked up with Gary Henley-Smith at Scott's, and they offered him obviously a scholarship to come over here and carry on with his running and so he can be part of the New Zealand program.
It makes sense for me to run for the black and white rather than the green and gold. I was born there, I was raised there, and like New Zealand, I love the atmosphere, I love the people. I see everything beautiful about the country. Like, it makes me feel like I'm safe with them.
You feel like $1 million now?
I do now, sir. Someone put me in a quarterback position.
Ah, Scott's College, man. Oh, man. That school, oh, man. It's like one of the best Wellington schools and possibly one of the best schools in New Zealand, man.
So this is the gym. This is the Scott's College gym. And this is all the New Zealand Secondary School Championships. And the man on the wall, Stephen Adams. Came here from 2008 to 2011.
Eddie, he's pretty special. I think he could be one of the world's best in his particular area, in sprinting. And there's no doubt that he has the potential to do that. He's highly competitive, and I think that's probably shown last year, particularly in his racing. He doesn't like to lose.
Who thought that I'll actually be traveling around the world at the age of 18? Going to Doha, man, it was a dream. At first it was scary, like I was like 48 fastest in the world. I'm like, oh geez, it's gonna be really hard for me to make the semis. Came just 0.01 milliseconds off the semifinals. I'm like, ah, man, so close, so close. To survive in the game, you gotta be mentally strong. You just gotta worry about your training and yourself, man. It's an individual sport. You're on your own. Every time I face the top sprinters, I bring the best out of myself because like I really want to like show these guys that I'm actually a contender for the titles one day. So to be one of the best, you gotta have the best mental game that you can ever produce. Or you won't survive in the top level of the game.
Wonderful repping.
Ngā tāngata kua waihanga I tētahi mea hiringanui, he tangata I whakangungua. Ki te kore he whakakitenga, ka ngaro te iwi.
All around the country and all around the world, you've got closed boardrooms full of old white men. That when I look at the issues, I don't think trying to change the mind frames of people who are older and are stuck in their ways is worth the resource or the energy. I think putting my energy into young people is the key. Ko Tamatha Paul tōku ingoa, a heri tēnei no Ngāti Awa me Waikato Tainui hoki. E tipu ake au I Tokoroa, engari I noho ana au ki Pōneki I noanei. I'm a Wellington City Councillor, which means that I am a local politician, which is crack up. My responsibilities are for the central city. I chose to run for this area because it's where all the young people are, where all our rangatahi are, where all our tauira or our students are. And I've just come off being the president of my university, which is dope because I'm the first person in my whānau to go to university. I'm from a place called Tokoroa, and Tokoroa is a small-ish rural town in the central North Island. Very big Cook Island Māori community, a big Samoan community, big Filipino community, so lots of different cultures there. You're dealing with a town that has been neglected by every system that's been put in place to help people. We've got like decile one schools. If you're in a low decile school, they're not lining you up for uni. There's a lack of jobs there, a lack of support services, and for that we get a bad rap in the media. Everyone outside of that town is telling you that you're destined to be a statistic.
Uni is really stressful for everybody. Doesn't matter how rich your family are or where you come from. If it isn't your studies, then it's your finances. And if it isn't your finances, then it's your health. But what are we actually going to do about it?
Being the first person in my family to go to uni, I could see all the barriers there were to education. Barriers that stem from it being a very Western institution that makes young brown people feel like they're stupid or that they're not good enough, when really it's just the institution that hasn't grown at all over the last 100 years. I was like, maybe I can remove some of those barriers to people like myself. Leading an organisation at the age of 21 taught me a lot of things and gave me a lot of tools. I wanted more because in my mind, the tertiary student population is still overwhelmingly quite privileged, but actually it's the people that aren't in unis that I probably care about more. It's the people that my parents call themselves the working poor, so they work full time but they have no money. It's people like my family, it's people who are incarcerated, who have been screwed over by our justice system, screwed over by our courts. So I did a big campaign. It was like my first like taste at, you know, what a campaign's like. My interactions with the council, I felt that my voice as a rangatahi wasn't being valued.
Over the last 3 years, I've worked with communities and organisations to create real grassroots change for our beautiful city.
I felt the issues that we cared about were seen as irrelevant. That's why I wanted to run.
I've worked on sexual violence prevention campaigns like Don't Guess the Yes. I've helped bring in public funding for young people's mental health support services.
5, 6, 7, 8, let's end the wait!
It is the collective hope that we, as students, want to learn in an environment in which mental health services are accessible and in which we all feel comfortable talking to one another about how we're feeling.
I thought I could win because the frustration that I felt, I knew other people in the community were feeling it as well. And I knew that there was an appetite for change. Because I had a team of probably like 40 or 50 people who were just like, yeah, I'll give you a Saturday, I'll give you a Sunday morning, I'll go knock on some doors for you, yeah, yeah, we'll do that. Went to events on events on events on events, talked, so much talking, and then October, cracked it.
If I had to make one decision right now and I could make any decision, I think what I'd do as I'd take cars out of the central city and I would just only let it be used for public transport, biking, walking, e-scootering and stuff, because there's way too many cars and that's where the majority of our emissions come from.
When we look at older people in those sectors of government or councils, they don't currently understand what rangatahi are going through. With Tam sitting in those positions at those tables, you have kind of faith in a system to be able to like comprehensively understand what we're going through, as well as finding solutions that will actually work.
We're here at the Vodafone Event Centre in Manukau, and there's lots of rangatahi here who have been brought together by Te Tau Rāwhiti, which is the Māori Language Commission. And so we're just here for a few days exploring our reo and exploring what it's like to be a rangatahi or a young Māori person in Aotearoa. My life kind of started when I went to uni, so I went to Victoria University down in Wellington, finished last year. This year my job has been the president of the Student Association at Vic, so what that pretty much means is head student of Vic, so it's like a full-time job. And then I ran for a seat for Wellington City Councillor in the Central City and was able to win it.
It's a real honour to have Tamatha as a part of our lineup of speakers. Her energy, her story, and her passion in terms of commitment to the kaupapa are exactly who we want our rangatahi to see.
Māori make up 15% of Aotearoa's population, but we make up over 50% of prison population. And for women, we make up 65% of the prison population. Anyway, we're going to learn how to fix all that, don't you worry. We know that rangatahi are the ones with the best experience and knowledge of what our solutions should be like. So just trying to draw that out of them, but most of all, just trying to have these rangatahi go away with a feeling of empowerment, like they can go home and start working on issues that they care about.
Although this world seems to be guided by systems that serve a particular type of person and big money, there's like a glitch in the matrix, and that glitch is the people. I thought that change happened in the beehive, but really, when you get down to it, the real change happens in the communities with the people, because the common experience in New Zealand is not the one represented in Parliament. We need normal people, everyday people, in positions to change things and positions of power. Like teachers, nurses, people with a criminal record, people who have been members of gangs before, people who didn't go to uni. We need real people being our decision makers.
Kaore e tāia te pānuni I ngā mea katoa ka tūtakina. Engari, e kore e tāia tētahi mea, te pānuni kia tūtaki rā anō. Patu ngarungaro te tangata, toi tū te whenua.
People that slow down the vision. I just need people that do know the difference. All being deserving and being so lucky. You know it's just luck you were born in this country. Know it's just luck that your life is so comfy and everything is good and things are so sunny.
You know, any immigrant, it's very hard to figure out who you are as a person, because you're not quite this, but you're not quite that either. You're somewhere stuck in between.
I'm from Bangladesh, call me Gordon Ramji. Young boy feeding, but I'm more than hungry. Well, I made news that my girlmates come before me, I'm blessed.
My name is Abid Rahman. I go by Abid. My artist name is Abrzy. Born in Dhaka, Bangladesh. And now I live in the greatest city in the world, Wellington, New Zealand.
Yo, what's up?
Hey.
How's it?
So I left Bangladesh like 4 or 5 years old, so growing up, I've only got few memories. All those memories from like kindergarten, primary school sort of washed over the memories that were in Bangladesh. It's definitely a challenge because I didn't speak English. We're immigrants. We're trying to get accustomed to the life. I was probably one of the few Muslim kids in the area. There were just a lot of bullying, like a lot of name calling. You're Muslim, so you're a terrorist. That's an automatic equation in a lot of people's head. The 11th of September, someone came up to me and was like, this must be your favorite day. Anything that related to Muslim terrorists on the news, that would somehow circle back to you at school.
Oh yeah, man, you know I was born in. A lot of strain, a lot of pain at your door, man.
growing up in Wellington, if we focus on high school, which is when I really started rapping, it was amazing. Like, for the first time in my life, I found a really good group of friends that was supportive. And the school that I went to was just so open to people being different and doing things creative and standing out. That really pushed me to do the music thing.
I love to entertain people, and this is what I do better than anything in my life. My songs are just a collection of moments or experiences that I just paint over beats. Like, this duality exists between myself as a person, in terms of, like, yes, I live in Wellington, but I also have the strong connection back home. Definitely all the experiences that I have over there and, like, the struggle, the resilience, what people have to do to get by, those are stuff that I write in my music. Yeah, we just landed. We just came from like a 25, 26 hour flight. It feels amazing coming back to my home city where I was born. Just the smells, the heat, the noise, it's an assault to the senses, but it's in a good way, you know? Like, it's so different to New Zealand, but at the same time, it's so familiar. This is my people, like, you know, we look alike. It's surreal because it's like New Zealand, you sort of stand out because you don't fit the mold, and I felt that my whole life. But then I come here and I'm just like, I'm just the same as everyone else. It's just home, I can't explain it. It's some sort of like spiritual pull to me. So this is my granddad. We call him Dada. That's like Bengali for granddad. That's my Dada. And that's my grandma in that photo up there. Yeah, unfortunately she passed away 2010. Yeah, I was really close with her. And this is my Fiyo Shachu. That's my dad's cousin. And this is my dad's oldest brother. I call him Chachu, or Boro Chachu. So Boro means like big, and Chachu means uncle, so yeah. And we're just here having a feed. Hey, hey, hey. This is the school that I went for like 1 year. Looking at those kids' faces, I see like a piece of me there. Like New Zealand ekta desh, Australia pashe. Shuns tomar ki New Zealand naam shunso. So I just asked, have you guys heard of New Zealand? And they were like, yeah, they played New Zealand cricket final, which is sick. That they know New Zealand. A lot of people are born into poverty. They don't ask for this, they don't deserve this. And at the same time, on the flip side, you don't deserve the wealth that you accompany because you were born into wealth. Seeing what, you know, the other side of life is like, it's hard when you think that that's just life is and it's unfair and you can't do anything about it. So there's different opportunities in New Zealand compared to Bangladesh. You definitely get a, I guess, more head start on life. Tiger, tiger, tiger. Hip-hop's given me a sense of purpose. The genre itself was born out of struggle, and that's an instant connection right there. Like, you're born into your ethnicity, you can't choose your background or your race. Most people are born into your religion, like whatever your parents are, that's what you are. All these adversities in your way, like looking back at it, you realize it's just a moment or a phase. So once the path is clear for you, you just go towards that and you know who you are and you're content with yourself. Yes, you're an immigrant and used to think that I can't be this and that, but and in fact you can, like life isn't black and white and you can have this duality that represents who you are.
Amione costo core dure giabo. Gianietone cotina mi parbo.
Just feel like this deeper connection coming here with the music and the people and everything. And I think I really want it to resonate to my music, like, you know, really represent the nation or the area I'm from and the people. I think that's such a blessing. Family just lie to your face because they need a little money to stay at the place, but then you find out to get high pop in the veins. Like, whoa, I can't even blame them. That's just the environment that they put the kids. Yeah, it's just been an incredible journey, and I'm so blessed that I can do that with my music and represent my people and try really break barriers and show that it doesn't matter, like, where you're from, but it's where you end up.
Me nā kāore a hau e aro ki a hau anua. Mā waike. Ā, me nā ka aro a hau ki a hau anahe. He aha a hau. Ka mutu, me nā kaua inaia nei. Hei, āhea.
Supporting local content so you can see more of New Zealand on air.